Kelly 01 said, thanks for reaching out. No, sorry. Thanks for the reaction to 21 Pilots Stressed Out. The black paint on the hands and neck represents his insecurities and anxiety. That's interesting. He is insecure about things he creates, in parentheses, music, and suffocating is the closest to the, sorry, I need to hit read more, to the feeling of anxiety, neck pain, in parentheses. This was recorded in real childhood homes in Columbus. Yeah, we heard that in a couple other comments too. This was in Columbus, Ohio. I'm going to guess the folks who mentioned it was filmed in Columbus, Ohio, are from the great state of Ohio.
Columbus,
because like a lot of folks know their local bands very well. So, but thanks, Kelly. If I'm saying this right, Kelly 01.
Beer.
Today's episode is brought to you, not brought to you by Duff Beer, because Homer. What are you drinking over there, Dave? Just hot water? Tea?
Iced tea with lemon.
Is it sweet tea?
No.
Sir, I'll say, sir, I don't think I can do this show anymore with you.
I don't like sweet tea. Well, I mean, sometimes, but not when I'm like really thirsty.
You don't need all the sugar buzz associated with sweet tea, but I'm a huge fan of sweet tea. And even before I moved to the Peach State, I liked sweet tea over regular tea.
So have you ever gone down like a wormhole watching videos on YouTube and you stumble across something and it's some cool information and it's about a person that you've known about but didn't really know a lot about? In this one instance, I stumbled on this video by the Rig Doctor, Vertex Effects. He did a breakdown and of a rig for Wendy Melvoin, who was the guitar player for the Revolution, Purple Rain, Prince's band. And I saw some interesting things on there about her. You know, she uses her thumb to mute and play notes in it, kind of along the lines of, I think Hendrix did it. Have you ever seen that or have you ever tried that?
Using my thumb? No, and I know some people use it for muting. Some people actually use it for notes kind of higher up on the neck. Cannot do it. Sometimes when I'm playing guitar, I feel like all I have is thumbs, but no, I've never used the thumb for muting. Typically I'll use a palm.
For me, I have really short, stocky fingers and it's always come natural. I don't even know if I ever consciously tried to do it. It's just how I fret and how I hold certain chords. It just, you know, comes natural to me. So I've done that before and I I do it all the time basically. But, you know, this video is kind of cool because, you know, this company, Vertex Effects, the Rig Doctor, built this awesome pedal board to her specs and she used it for the Grammys. She played guitar on the Grammys this year, and she does a lot of ambient stuff for soundtracks and whatnot. But I realized she's probably one of the most underrated guitar players from the 80s. So I don't know. I think we should dive in a little bit deeper.
Yeah, it's a good idea. Do you think that maybe because who she was playing with, it cast a very big shadow on her and everyone just assumed it was Prince? But that's today's episode, right? That's what we want to talk about today, is not necessarily her failing as a guitarist or like what she was recognized for. What she should be heralded for is the beginning of the song that set the stage for a lot of modern popularity, or the biggest boost in popularity that Prince got, and was the song Purple Rain. right?
Yeah. So in this video, she talks about how, you know, she got the gig and, oh, wait, let's back up. We're going to do a dude. We got to.
Yeah, we should. All right. Hey there. Welcome to another episode of
Dude.
Check this out. What are we going to talk about today, Dave?
We are going to talk about guitars.
Nice.
But first, we want to remind everyone watching, all a handful of you, to like and subscribe. Share it with people. Spread the news. It's free to subscribe to these YouTube channels, and every little every subscription helps us a lot. So we'd appreciate it if you could spread the love.
Spread the love. And we're still committed to doing a live stream when we get to 1,000 subscribers. So share with everybody you know, even if you just want to see two jokers fail miserably doing their very first live show.
And we have a Facebook page. You can find us there. We have an Instagram and what else?
TikTok.
So yeah,
just started there.
So yeah, look for us on those different networks. So yeah, on today's episode, you know, I wanted to expand a little bit, talk a little bit about Wendy Melvoin. You know, we've talked about in the past, one of the great session groups, the Wrecking Crew. They did a lot of the West Coast stuff, Beach Boys, you know, you name it, they played on it. Wendy's father was a pianist for the Wrecking Crew.
What?
And pianist?
A what? Sorry, I just had to. The 12-year-old in me came out, man. I'm sorry.
Piano player.
There you go. Much better.
Yeah. And, you know, Wendy was also the girlfriend of Lisa Coleman, who was the Lisa, the keyboard player for the Revolution. And, and Lisa Coleman, also her father was in the Wrecking Crew as a percussionist. But anyways, Wendy and Lisa would always, you know, of course they're dating, they're hanging out all the time. And around
lot of dreaming when they wrote stuff, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Around 1982, Wendy was visiting Lisa while they were filming videos for Controversy, and they were in her hotel room, and Wendy was playing her guitar, just messing around, and Prince walked by and all of a sudden came in the room and said, "Who was playing that?" And, you know, Wendy's like, "Well, I was. And so he's like, "Play me something." So, you know, she's like, "What do I do? I can't play a Prince song in front of Prince." So she just played a chord that stretched an octave and a half, and he just, like, his jaw dropped and was like, "Wow." So a couple days later, I mean, short story long, she was at a rehearsal, and the current guitar player, Des Dickerson. But he didn't show up for sound check. So Wendy was there, and he's like, "Hey, do you know Controversy?" And she didn't, but she told him, "Yeah, I know it," because she had watched him, you know, play the chords over and over during the video that they were recording.
Yeah.
And so he's like, "Okay, get up on stage, play it." And he was going to walk around the arena to check the sound and whatnot. And so that passed. And a few days later, she was asked to join the band, because apparently that Des Dickerson was out. So that's how she joined Prince and the Revolution. And they were also getting ready to film, or they were filming Purple Rain, the movie. And she did a debut show with them. And what did he say? Prince came to the band with the basic of the song Purple Rain. He had the melody and the chords and the lyrics, and asked the band to come up with an intro. And she came up with the one of the most famous guitar intro chord, single chord you'll recognize in all of, almost all of music. So they did their first show, benefit concert, and he sent her out on stage and she played almost 10 minutes. Of just her playing that intro to Purple Rain. And she's 19 years old, up on stage, first time. That night is when they recorded live what you hear on the album, Let's Go Crazy, Computer Blue, Purple Rain, Baby I'm a Star, and I Would Die for You. All those songs, the basic tracks, were recorded live from that show. They went on to do some overdubs and whatnot, but 19 years old. So some of her other credits, you know, I don't know if you wanted to add in anything on that.
No, I'm good.
I know I've got a lot of information I'm throwing out here, but you know, you find out about somebody and you're like, wow, she is underrated. I mean, she has guitar credits for partially writing Purple Rain, even though you won't find it anywhere. This is her words. She had writing input on Computer Blue. She also was the guitar player for Rob Thomas's first solo album, Matchbox 20, Rob Thomas. She was a guitar player for Glenn Campbell's final album before he passed away. She did the guitars for Apollonia 6, which was in Purple Rain. She did a couple albums with Sheryl Crow, the Globe Sessions, and Come On, Come On. She did guitar work for Seal and for Madonna's last album. And that's, you know, there's many more, but those are just some of the big ones. So she's all over the place. Not to mention she does soundtrack work for a lot of movies. And I believe she was nominated for an award for one of her TV shows. I forget which one, but yeah, Wendy Melvoin, I mean, amazing guitar player.
She's the one that came up with that intro, and it's the reason we're talking about it today, which is the top five iconic intros to songs that are just guitar.
Yes.
And I'm murdering the title of this right now. We'll wordsmith it. You'll hear a digital version of my voice afterwards.
The most recognizable guitar song intros.
I'll put it this way. It's the only part of the song we learned.
Yeah. To all your kids sitting in your bedroom, well, back in the 80s or 90s for me when I started playing, you know, that's the only part when somebody asks you, hey, do you know how to play that song? What do you know how to play? Yeah, listen. Bling. And then it's like, cool. What else do you know?
Keep going. And you're like, That's all I know. That's all I remembered. It took me 4 hours to figure that out.
I think we can agree there are two songs that are just instant. I mean, we've talked about Purple Rain, so That's one of them. You hear that first chord and you just, you know what it is. The other one, which is kind of, it's not really a single guitar chord. It is a mishmash of guitar chords, bass notes, and I think even a piano chord, and that's A Hard Day's Night. And I'm going to insert audio clips during the edit, and they may or may not show up in the final cut, depends on how nice or how YouTube wants to play
something. Nothing for you.
So you may just see an image of the player or the band, or you might hear the actual tune. So you know, we'll see how it goes. So if you don't hear something, and just imagine it in your mind, you'll know it. I'm looking at your list, and I see one of my favorite songs on your list, and I should have put it on mine, but when you get to it, I'll let you know. But
okay, I'm not. There is no particular order, number one or number 10. It's just a list, but I'm going to start from the bottom of my list, right? the one I'd see is probably iconic for me is "Drop Dead Legs" by Van Halen.
That is one of my favorite songs from 1984. It just, I don't really know what to say about it. It just sounds incredible.
And it's relatively easy to play. Not that I could ever play it like him, but like it is probably one of the least difficult of his songs to play. All right, the next one is Pinball Wizard by The Who. And if my guitar wasn't tuned onto an open, I would play it at the beginning of it. But
That starts on acoustic, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I'll...
Although I think in concert, I think Townsend has played it on an electric. Recorded at the acoustic.
I'll start with I'll give you a couple of mine towards the bottom of my list, and mine is a little bit longer than yours, so maybe I'll do a couple of quick ones.
Yeah, go for it.
Paranoid, Black Sabbath. I mean, that's pretty iconic. Same with Photograph by Def Leppard.
Yeah, that would put them front and center for me. That's on.
Yeah, I don't know. These are further down my list, and a couple of them, you know, like I Can't Get No Satisfaction. That's a lot of these are riffs, but that's a pretty, you know, for me to throw a Rolling Stones song on my list is,
yeah,
it must mean something about that song, because, you know, I'm Team Beatles.
Yeah, and I always give Dave a hard time, because if we were to try to choose between the Beatles and the Stones, I would pick the Stones. So see, right. That's how we get along. We think differently and we get along. It's fine. There's nothing wrong
with all that. Right.
Yeah.
What else you got?
Okay. Let's see where. I do like your list though, man. It's a good list. So for those who are wondering what the hell we're talking about, we have a shared Google Doc that we put our run of show notes together. And so I get to see his list. So there's no surprise for me.
You know what? It's probably a good idea we go through all of these, because I'm guessing a handful of these are going to get blocked.
Yeah.
So, you know, we can... You know, I'll have something to work with once it gets rejected by the evildoers.
Nothing for you.
Evildoers, I say unto thee. Yes. Okay. All right. So next up, do we just want to do two at a time then? Is that what we want to do?
Yeah, sure. Sure.
Okay, cool. So my next two would be Under the Bridge by Red Hot Chili Peppers.
That's an incredibly difficult. I don't know how he does it. Prashanthi is a wizard.
He's got alien hands. Let's just put it that. Prashanthi is he's ridiculously talented.
Yeah,
I'm glad to see he's still around. I really am, because he had some hard times. All right, next would be Dimebag Darrell. Rest in peace, brother. Walk by Pantera.
I'm not as familiar with Pantera as I don't know if I should be, or I just, you know, they never really hit my radar. But I know a little bit of that song. Yeah, that's pretty. Pretty sweet.
Let's it is see. My favorite of the Pantera songs is that one. And yeah. Even
do they do Cemetery Gates?
I think,
or is that Corrosion of Conformity?
I think, hold on a second, let me go look at Pantera.
Let's see. The next one on my list is just a, this one could fall into that single. This is a single note and it's a harmonic. It's For What It's Worth by Buffalo Springfield. I don't. Do you know it?
No, I don't. I'm sure it, as always, something that I, off the top of my head, can't think of. I probably have heard it before, but I can't. It's not ringing a bell. Ringing a bell with me right now.
Well, you'll know. Cemetery you'll Gates. Know when you hear it.
Cemetery Gates is a Pantera song.
Okay. Let's see, for what it's worth. Here's one. The song that we used to, me and Ann in our band, we used to play much later, and that was Summer of 69 by Bryan Adams. Just that opening chord. It's a pretty iconic riff. I'll do one more real quick.
Okay.
Bad Company, Can't Get Enough of Your Love. That's a pretty much an opening chord. What else?
Awesome.
You like my list, don't you?
It's good. The list is good. All right. So the next two I've got are, I don't know what I was thinking. I was on a, what I started to do is I went through my list of my library of just bands and in Apple Music that I've downloaded. And I got to a point where it was all just heavy stuff. But this other one is Break Stuff by Limp Bizkit. People might not like Limp Bizkit at all, but I do like this song. Everything else just can suck. I don't care, but like Break Stuff. And then my next one is, we're doing two in a row, Folsom Prison Blues by
I remember how that one starts, but
there is a is a very echoey, very Sun Studios type sound with that song for sure.
Okay. I'll have to give her a listen. Let me do a couple. I think you're gonna
have two left, so go for it.
Yeah, I got, geez, I got so many. AC/DC, You Shook Me All Night Long. That chord just kind of rings out. So yeah, I'll put that in. Next up, I have another fun one that we played as a band. We did The Ocean by Led Zeppelin. More or less a riff, but probably in my top 3-4 Led Zeppelin songs. That's off of the Houses of the Holy album. Let's see, I've got 4 left, so I'll do
2 more.
I'll do 2 more. This one is heavily tremolo.
Here we go again.
Tremolo. heavy trem effect. And that's the Smiths, How Soon Is Now. And it's, I love the song from the 80s. I mean, it's just, this one is probably a little not suspected for a guitar intro songs, but when you hear it, you know exactly what song it is, and that is Fight for Your Right by the Beastie Boys.
Yeah,
exactly.
It is. That's funny with the Beastie Boys. Like, there's a couple of songs where you're like, it's not sampled, it's actually an instrument, which I thought was kind of cool.
Yeah, and it's one of them playing it.
Yeah. All right, I'll drop my next two then. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
All right. Lonely is the Night by Billy Squire.
That's my favorite, one of my favorite songs of the 80s all time. Just the tone, everything about that song, I love it. Billy Squire at his finest.
I wonder if like they wrote that opening riff and then we're like, dude, we gotta put a song around that, because it was kind of cool.
Yeah. I guess I would bet a lot of these are stuff that they would warm up to or had riffs kind of laying around back and forth that they would noodle with. And yeah, like here's one that we probably left off our list, like the beginning of Sweet Child of Mine. That was just something goofy that Slash would mess around with, and look what that turned into. So
it wound up being like, it blends very well into it, but if you think about how Izzy Stradlin plays the rhythm guitar on that, you're like, if you pulled Slash out of this, the song loses some depth. But it is just probably them trying to figure out how to write this really cool, mellow song. But all right. So my last one on the list is Pride by U2. And when we first started talking about doing this episode, is it the first note? Is it the first, you know, measure? Is it the first riff? And I thought about how different this song would be if Edge didn't have his signature echo in there that he has. Tape delay, I think it might even be, like, he might have used a Roland tape delay in that song, because he's famous for his use of delay effects in his guitar playing. So that's the other one I had, was Pride. You hear that first opening note with the echo, I guess, and you know what you're going to hear next.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's, I love that song too. I think that was one of my first CDs I ever got. It was that and Open Up and Say Ah by Poison, back when CDs came out. My first CD player, those were the first two. My last two, you know, it was hard for me to narrow down just one from Alex Lifeson, but Limelight by Rush. My favorite guitar tone. I think he played that, if I remember, I thought he played it on a Strat, actually. It was either a Strat or his 335, but gosh, I love that song. And I have one more. Thin Lizzy, The Boys Are Back in Town. Yes. That's a good opening chord song. Yeah. That's what I got as far as intros. I mean, there's a billion more that could go on this list, but you know, these are my favorites. I mean, you know, when you pick up guitar and you learn how to play, I mean, some of these songs are the first things that you want to try. I know, Paranoid was one of my early ones. Limelight, when I finally took some lessons.
Able to afford like effects pedals and distortion pedals, right? There's our list. If you've got some opening riffs that you feel are iconic that we may have missed, you might also notice that some of this stuff is like not current. Like a lot of the stuff we're talking about is from the past, because how do you become an iconic song? You have to get played. You have to wind up 20 years down the road, either in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, or you hear this band again on what your local radio station would call the classics channel, right? Which for me, I cry when I hear that. And it's a song that I grew up with, because now I'm a classic, right? But anyways, but if we miss something that you think we should consider as an iconic guitar opening, make a comment down below and like and subscribe and share and get your friends to have a discussion about this.
Yeah, I would love to hear any input. Yeah, I'm sure there's some modern bands we probably gonna throw it on here. Black Keys has I think Lonely Boy has a great intro, the Strokes definitely have some great guitar intros. Now that I'm thinking, some of the stuff I should have.
We do this every time. We got that band on. Oh.
I remember that one. Yeah. So. Yeah. So until next time.
This has been
Dude.
Check this out. See you later.
Play your guitar.
Yeah, play your guitar and stop touching that.
This too.
So that's today's episode.
Yeah. So
crash and burn there, man. Crash and burn. Man.
It kind of petered out.
Hold on. We got that sound effect. We can do that. Hold on. All right. Take three. I'm just kidding. Oh, every time. Oh. I felt like this today. I had a head cold. What's going on here? Come on, camera. See? There we go.
There you go.